Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Get your Bibles out and turn with me to Luke, the fifth chapter. Luke, the fifth chapter. And tonight I want to talk to you about a subject called Fishing Lessons from the Master. Fishing lessons from the Master. Now, this is not a natural thing. Obviously, when I say the Master, I'm talking about Jesus himself. You know, in the Gospels, we find that Jesus had a lot to do with fishing. Now, I myself would not consider myself or even my family to be a fisherman or a fishing type family. My son loves it. And so, you know, I went out and bought him a rod and a reel and all that kind of stuff on his birthday. What was it? Last year, right? On his seventh birthday, I think it was. He went out, and we went to this little lake, and we were on family vacation, and so Uncle Luke, the fisherman, you know, he's more the fly rod guy, you know, and so he taught us how to do that. So when it came to this angler thing, he kind of helped us a little bit, got us set up, and so my son cast out into the lake, and I remember I was just sitting there praying. I was like, Lord, you know, I do not know how to fish, and it's my son's birthday, God, and so if Lord, you choose, God, would you just bless him on his birthday to catch his first fish? Wouldn't that be special, God? What a birthday present that would be. Lo and behold, we're sitting there, and the kids are playing in the dirt, and they got their rods all set up, you know? And the end of that reel all of a sudden starts doing this number, right? Any fisherman knows that's good movement right there. So I said, hey, you know, and I call him Bubba. I said, Bubba, go get your reel. And so he runs over there and grabs it, and he starts reeling, and I'm not too fast, you know, just give him a little tug and then start reeling him in, you know? And he reeled in his first rainbow trout, probably about like this big, man. Oh my goodness. We put him in a Ziploc bag and took him back and we ate the sucker. He was so good. It was tasty. A little butter and garlic. So anyways, that part I can do. You know, I can eat the fish. Just catching them is a little difficult for me. You heard the one about the lady, right? Went fishing with her husband. You guys hear about that lady? She went and she told her neighbor about the experience. She said she did everything wrong. She was too loud, she used the wrong kind of bait, she reeled it in too soon, she caught more than him. I mean, she just did everything wrong. It was all wrong. I love you guys. Love you guys. Just ask your neighbor later on, they'll tell you what that was all about. It's all good. Luke chapter 5, enough with the jokes. Luke chapter 5, starting in verse number 4, let's learn some lessons from the Master. Verse number 4, it's kind of interesting. Let me just give you some context. Jesus has gone on a circuit. He's been preaching all the synagogues. The people now have come out and they're thronging him. He's up against the lake and he decides, well, you know what? I'm here at the lake and I need a little bit of personal space when I'm preaching, you know? And so he decides he's going to jump in. There's two boats there. So he jumps in one of the boats and the owner of the boat, one is Peter. He's actually had interaction with Peter before. In fact, when he went to Peter's house, Peter's mother-in-law was sick with a fever. Jesus laid hands on her and rebuked the fever. And she got up right then and there and started serving and just doing dishes and doing different things and attending to the people's needs and stuff like that. And so Peter saw miracles. Peter had heard about Jesus, you know? The television of the day was probably just people talking. Hey, did you hear about what happened at the wedding? Yeah, this guy Jesus, his mama was there, and she went and got him, and he turned the water into wine. They were out of wine, but he turned the water into wine, and the wine was so good that everybody was complimenting on it afterwards. So here he had heard, here he had seen personally, and now Jesus steps into Peter's boat and says, could you just get away from the shore a little bit? These people are thronging me. I need to teach them. And so he's talking, he's teaching, he's preaching, speaking about the kingdom of God. And then all of a sudden, in verse number 4, take a look at what Jesus does. Luke, the fifth chapter, verse number 4, it says, when he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. Now, right there, we see that Jesus knows something. That Jesus now, he's not just saying something just to say it. See, when Jesus was here on the earth, everything he did had purpose. Everywhere he went, he said, I must go through. I got to do this. He set his face like a flint. Everything Jesus did was on purpose. So now here he is in Peter's boat. He's been preaching and teaching. And now he tells Peter, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. Verse 5, but Simon answered and said to him, Master, we've toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. So Peter states the obvious to Jesus. Hey, we've been fishing all night. Nighttime is the right time for fishing. The fish don't see the net coming. They're not scared by the light rays going through the water. You know, it's past the time for fishing. Yet, Jesus, I've heard and I've seen, and so therefore I'm going to do right now. Now look at what happens, verse number 6. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. My goodness, that's got to be a lot of fish. Verse 7, so they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. How many of you know that's a lot of fish? These boats probably were about 15 foot long, and these fishermen now have filled up their boats so much so that the boats are starting to sink. Wow. Pretty crazy. Verse number 8, when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. He recognized and realized that, you know what, I gave you my 2 cents about fishing, and I just did this at your word, but yet, Jesus, you're the master. Yet, Jesus, you are Lord. Only you could know, only you could command the fish. This has got to be the Messiah, the chosen one, the anointed one who is to come. This would be the king of Israel, and therefore, what are you doing hanging out with me? I'm a sinful man. He realizes when he has an encounter with Jesus, and he recognizes the authority and the holiness of God, and he falls down on his knees and says, depart from me, for I'm a sinful man, O Lord. Verse number 9, for he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. So also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, do not be afraid. From now on, you will catch men. Now, I want to pull out some truths about some lessons that Jesus gives here in this story, and then we're going to jump into another fishing story. Like I said, there's a bunch of them throughout the Gospels that we find that Jesus used the analogy of fishing. And tonight I've got 4 lessons that we can pull out of the Word of God, lessons from the Master. See, Jesus told these guys, don't be afraid. You don't have to cast me away. I'm not going to smite you. I'm not here to Bible bash you or anything like that. But rather, I'm here to change your occupation. You're going to go from being a fisherman to a fisher of men. Peter, you thought you had smarts, you thought you had wisdom, you thought you had knowledge. Now Jesus schools him and shows him who the real master is. But then now that he's got his attention, he changes the script. And for all of us, if we've had an encounter with Jesus, if you've given your heart and your life to the Lord, now God has taken you. He has changed your heart. He's changed your life. Now that moment you said yes to Jesus and you were born again, that miracle has taken place in your life and he has changed your occupation. Now no longer are you just aimless. Now no longer do you not have purpose. Now God has commissioned each and every Christian on the planet. That's why you're still here, by the way. It's why you weren't just zapped up into heaven the moment you said yes. Yes, Lord, I give you all my heart and all my life. And then, you know, or whatever that Star Trek noise is, beam me up, Jesus. And we all go to heaven. Why did he leave us here? Here's why, because he has a purpose. He has a plan for every Christian. He's got a divine design that he wants us to be flowing with. And he wants to inaugurate all of us, commission all of us to become fishers of men. So we have to learn how to do it. As much as we know in the natural, as much as we could have said, well, you know, Peter, he was a fisherman, therefore he qualified to be a fisher of men. And yet Peter couldn't catch anything that night. It wasn't until he had an encounter with Jesus and he obeyed the voice of the Lord and learned the lesson from the master that he could be effective in what he was doing. And it's no different from us. We need to learn how to be fishers of men, but we can only learn from the master. Lesson number 1 for tonight is this. Jesus knows the time and the place for fishing. Think about that for a second. Jesus knows the time and Jesus knows the place. Now, in our family, we have something that we call fact checking. Is this right? My beautiful wife on the front row over here. I am a fact checker. Okay? My little girl, Chloe, she is a fact checker. At times, my little guy, Titus, he will be a fact checker, and every now and then my wife will fact check me, and my other son, Micah, will fact check me. Now, you say, what on earth are you talking about, Pastor Dan? Here's what I'm talking about. You heard of a fish story, right? Well, I caught a fish this big, right? That's a fisherman story. Sometimes, in a pastoral evangelical family, we might evangelize a little bit in our stories from time to time, right? So to keep us clean, every now and then we fact check. Oh, no, it wasn't that color. It was actually gray, you know? And oftentimes, that's a little bit annoying to the storyteller, right? Don't fact check me. Listen, it was not gray. It was blue. No, it was definitely gray. Fact check, right? And so we've got this little thing that goes on when we're telling a story. My wife, oftentimes, she will just put up like the timeout, like, don't you fact check me right now. You know what I'm saying? Like, let me tell the story. Let me share my perspective on it. And I don't want to be fact checked. I just want to get through to the end. Later on, if you guys want to have your own intimate discussion without me and check all my facts, you can sure do that. Now, isn't it interesting here in the story? Jesus speaks to Peter in verse number 4. When he stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. And Peter decides he's going to fact check Jesus. Look at this. But Simon answered and said to him, Master, we've toiled all night and caught nothing. Jesus, it ain't the time for fishing. Nighttime is the time for fishing. It's cool. We can work. The fish won't see you. The light may... Jesus, come on. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. So, see, even though he might have stopped and said, no, Jesus, you know, come on. You really don't know nothing about fishing. You stick to teaching. You stick to the miracles. You stick to people. You stick to healing. You take care of that. I'll take care of this. Nevertheless, Jesus, at your word, I'll launch out. See, Jesus knows the time and the place for fishing. Because why? Jesus commands the fish. Is that right? He's the master of all. All things have been put under his feet. And this is God in the flesh. And therefore, Jesus would know. And Jesus would be able to declare to Peter. And Jesus would be able to bring about that great miracle in his life. Why? Because Jesus knows the time and the place. Sometimes people get off when it comes. Here's the lesson. Here's the real lesson. I hear people say, well, you know, it's just not the right time for me to be telling somebody about Jesus. I need to work on myself before I start doing that. I get that. I understand that. Sometimes people say this, well, you know, on the job, you know, I'm there to work a job. I got to give my time and I'm serving that master as unto the Lord, and therefore they deserve my time. That's not the time or the place for sharing the gospel. I get that and I agree with that. Other times I hear people say this, well, you know what? They've heard so much, you know, and they've been Bible bashed and they've heard from church and they were raised in church, and therefore, you know what? Me telling them again is not really going to do anything. It's not the time or the place. And I get that and I understand that. And yet Jesus is the master and Jesus knows the time and Jesus knows the place for fishing. If you're there with somebody and your life is a mess, and Jesus says, tell them about me, and you don't feel qualified, then guess what? Jesus says, hey, here's a fisherman who couldn't catch anything all night. He wasn't sufficient in himself to do the work, and yet it wasn't because of Peter that he caught the fish. It was because of Jesus that he caught the fish. And so Jesus qualified the called. Are you listening? He doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called. And if you will answer that call and walk in obedience, then Jesus will bring about the supernatural results. So when Jesus says to you, your life's a mess, but I want you to share the gospel with this person, you go and you share with them. You say, I feel like a hypocrite. Well, not if you don't speak hypocrisy. In other words, if you went to somebody and tried to share Jesus like you had it all together, yeah, you would have no anointing, you would have no grace. But if you go to somebody and you say, listen, God's still working on me. Listen, I know where you're at because I feel the same way. I'm a mess and yet I'm getting cleaned up. The Lord's doing a work on my heart and I'm learning and I'm growing. You wanna join me on this journey? You wanna join me and grow in the things of God? Oh my goodness, watch how many fish you catch. What if you're there on the job, you know, and you're working hard? And I agree. Listen, if you are being paid to do a job, you do that job. But on your breaks, it is open season. You have a fishing license and there is no limit. Okay? You bring your Bible to the lunchroom and you set it down in front of everybody. Come on. Turn with me in your Bible. Oh, you don't have a Bible? Here, you take mine. I brought my cell phone. I'll read to you. Yeah, go ahead. See, it's open season. After work, when they're walking to their car, oh my goodness, corner them. Get after them. Why not? Hey, you going to the bar? No, let's not go to the bar. Let's go over and get some wings over at Buffalo Wild, whatever thing. You know, Elijah will probably be there. He loves that place, man. You know, and we'll get some soda. You need to be sober for what I'm going to be talking to you about. All right? See, come on, somebody. See, it's open season when it's not time that you're being paid for. Yeah, you serve your earthly master and you work hard, and people will stand up and know, why you work so hard, man? You're making all of us look bad. Here's why, because I'm not working for the man. I'm working for God. See, that's a witness. They'll say, you're not like other Christians. No, I got the supernatural power of God. See, Jesus knows the time and the place. Somebody been told too much. Somebody just turned off to the gospel. But if God chooses the time and the place and says, I want you to go share, you go share and watch what God does. The results are not up to you. You just share the gospel in the power of the Holy Spirit and leave the results up to God. Are you listening? That's lesson number one for tonight, is that Jesus knows the time and Jesus knows the place for fishing. Lesson number two is this. Lesson number two is, don't be afraid to engage people on a deep spiritual level. It's really quiet in this place. Don't be afraid. Look at what Jesus said. Verse number four. When he stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the where? Oh, come on. There's more than two people in this place. Launch out into the where? Into the deep. In other words, don't just let this be a shallow experience with people. If you engage people on a shallow level, then they are going to respond on a shallow level. Now, you might get them to kind of taste the bait a little bit on the shallow level. But Jesus says, I don't want you to be afraid to launch out into the deep things. In fact, what's it say in the book of Psalms? Deep calls to deep, right? People have real questions. People have real hurts. People have real lives. And there are deep things on the inside of them that we cannot skirt around and just say, oh, well, you know, if you give your heart to the Lord, everything will just work itself out. That's not what Jesus is saying. It's not just, you know, this simple little shallow thing. No, those deep issues God has an answer for, they're all in here. And don't be afraid to engage them, because the more you put this on the inside of you, now there's like a library on the inside of you. So when they start asking questions about deep things and you don't know the answer, God will bring that rhema word, that spoken word, that now word to your memory. Remember the Holy Spirit's job description? I will remind you of all things which I have spoken. So if you've read this and if you've got this on the inside of you and if you've meditated on it, if you've rolled around and the more you've heard in church, then at the right time, in the right place, when Jesus says, launch out into the deep for a catch, you can launch out and you won't be out there on a limb by yourself. You'll have the wisdom that you need. In fact, in the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 3, if you want to turn there with me, just hold your finger in Luke. We'll come back there in a bit. Right after the Psalms and Proverbs, you find Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes chapter number 3, verse number 11. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse number 11 says this, he's made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity in their hearts, except that no one can find out the work that God does from beginning to end. I was looking up this in multiple passages, multiple translations, if you will, and as well studying the original language. Very interesting. It talks about he, speaking of God, there's a capital H on that, has put eternity in their hearts. Some translations say in the hearts of men. In other words, God has put something great on the inside of each and every person. God has put something so deep on the inside of people that, look at this, except that no one can find out the work that God does from beginning to end. It's incomprehensible, it's so great. It's huge. There is something built on the inside of every human being. And when you speak to that, they can't understand those terms. Why? Because no one can find out the work that God does from the beginning to the end. Remember, in the New Testament, it says, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, no mind has conceived the things that God has prepared for us, except that the Spirit has revealed them to us. So now, as a people, we have the Spirit of God who reveals to us the hidden counsels, the mysteries of God. And now, spiritually, we can discern the work that God does from beginning to end, right? Why? Because we have the Spirit of God, the teacher, who illuminates that into our hearts. And now when we start to speak in those terms to people, it just calls out to the deep things that are on the inside of them, the eternity that's on the inside of them. They know instinctively. They know because they have a conscience, and they know because God has planted on the inside of their hearts eternal things. And therefore, when you start to call out those eternal things, they will come into the net that you have cast. See, Jesus knows this. Jesus understands this. And that's why Jesus, you know, sometimes I hear people talk about the methods and the tactics of Jesus. And I get a little bit confused about what they're saying, because they say that Jesus never engaged people on a deep spiritual level. No, he may have started shallow like this. Woman at the well, right? Give me a drink of water. Little shallow thing, right? But look at what happened. She took the bait. How is it that you, a Jew, speak to me, a Samaritan? For the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Well, if you knew who you were talking to, you would have asked him for a drink. Well, wait a second. He took her from shallow to knee deep, right? Like in Ezekiel, when he's going in the river, started at the ankles. Now all of a sudden he's down to the knees. Eventually he gets into the waist until he finds a river so deep that he cannot cross it, right? So here's Jesus, starts with a drink of water. Then he says, you should be asking me for a drink. Eventually gets to the point where she says, sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. And now the deep thing of her heart is, wait a second, Jesus, I've got a deep issue on the inside. You guys worship at the temple. We worship on this mountain. Which one's right? And Jesus says, neither. There's coming a time when those who worship will worship in spirit and in truth, speaking eternal words that are deep, and it called out on the inside of her. And she was hooked for life. She took a drink of that water, and next thing you know, she's out evangelizing her city, going and telling all the people, hey, come listen to the guy who told me everything I had ever done. Now, the people knew about some of the things that she had done. They said, well, really, he's telling you all that? I got to go hear this guy, right? See, it may start shallow, but Jesus goes deep. Jesus went deep with all sorts of people. You find him having conversations, right? Here comes Zacchaeus, here comes Nicodemus, all these men and women that Jesus interacted with. And yet Jesus didn't leave them in the shallows. He took them deep. So should we. Don't be afraid to launch out into the deep for a catch. All right? Lessons. Lesson number three is this. Obedience on our part brings blessings only God can give. Obedience on our part brings blessings only God can give. If God tells you, I want you to go talk to your dad, and I want you to share the gospel with that man. You say, but God, do you know my dad? Right? He's hard. He's not going to receive. You know, he's the authority. I wouldn't be able to tell him anything. He wouldn't receive it from me. And yet if God tells you to go in obedience, your obedience will bring blessings only God can give. In fact, this is more than just a fishing lesson. This is every area of your life lesson right here. You know, if you can get a hold of this. But go back with me. You still got your finger in Luke, the fifth chapter. Look at what he says. Verse number 5, Simon answered and said to him, Master, we've toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. Verse number 6, and when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. My goodness. Now remember the rest of the story. Eventually they had two boats filled with fish sinking. That's a supernatural result. Why did that happen? All because Peter stepped out in faith on one little word from the God, launch out into the deep for a catch. Peter did not realize that he wasn't prepared for the blessing that was about to overtake him and his partners in business. Peter did not realize what was going to happen. And I believe that at this time, Jesus allowed the fish to break the nets because he was saying something. He was saying that this blessing is so big and so great, it's going to alter the course of your life. You will not need those nets any longer, because I'm going to make you fishers of men. You're going to be far more effective. You're going to be far more great in what you do being a fisher of men. And here Peter is the first one that we find, right? on the day of Pentecost preaching the gospel, and thousands get saved. Why? Because Peter launched out in obedience. So Peter went forth. Peter waited for the promise of the Holy Spirit. And then Peter came and he preached the gospel to the people. And now because of his obedience, it brought results that only God could bring. You're there in Luke chapter number 5. You can take your finger out of there. Go with me to the book of Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1. There's a great verse in Isaiah chapter number 1. One of those verses you might want to put to memory. Isaiah chapter 1, verse number 19. Look at what it says in Isaiah chapter 1, verse number 19. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. That's a great little verse just to memorize. And when God starts asking you to do something that's outside of your comfort zone, that doesn't line up with your thinking, because, you know, oftentimes God will ask you to do unusual things. And yet, when you step out in faith, those unusual things will yield unusual results. See, it wasn't usual to cast out a net after you had washed it during the day to pull up a bunch of fish. And yet, when they did something unusual, it yielded unusual results. In the same way, if God tells you, I want you to go down and I want you to buy a soda bottle and I want you to go stand and just go out to the city center and stand in the market and wait, that unusual request will yield an unusual result. You remember Philip, right? Here Philip is. Angel speaks to him, I want you to go out to the desert by this way. So he starts, goes out that way, sees a chariot. The angel speaks to him, I want you to go overtake that chariot. He goes up. Runs up by the chariot. What's he hear? He hears him reading the Bible. So he says, yeah, you understand what you're reading there? The guy says, well, how can I understand this? He gets in there, he preaches the gospel to him. When he's done preaching, the guy says, well, hey, there's some water right there. Shouldn't I be baptized? He says, all right, let's baptize you. Right? Baptizes the guy. And then, zap, all of a sudden, he's gone from that place and he shows up in another place. See, that unusual request, just go over here. Just go out to the desert. Yielded an unusual meeting, but it yielded also unusual results. My goodness, guys, what is God asking us to do? Sometimes because it doesn't line up with our thinking, or because it doesn't line up with our schedule, or because it doesn't line up with our pocketbook, or because it doesn't line up with what's acceptable to society, we say, well, that's unusual, that's weird, I don't think that's a good tool to catch people, you know, if Christians are weird, no one's going to want to join them. And yet, I see in the book of Acts a bunch of weird people doing a bunch of weird stuff, and they had the respect of everybody. You can read that in your Bible. Oh, I should have had a better clap. I'm not clapping for this weird preacher. So afraid of being weird, it's all right. Wear the red socks, guys. Come on, be strange. It's okay. Listen, you are a peculiar people. A royal priesthood, a holy nation. You are in the world, but you are not of the world. You're an alien. And people are going to look at you like an alien. They're going to wonder and scratch their head. But listen, if you are uncompromised and you're walking in obedience to the Lord, yeah, you might suffer some persecution. But guess what? There's going to be some people that look at you and they can say, I can see that you're not compromised. I can see that you're not a hypocrite. And you've got much respect, my brother. See, that's what this is all about. If we're going to be fishers of men, we got to learn these lessons of fishing from the master. Last lesson for tonight, John chapter 21. Turn there with me. Let's read through this and we'll learn the last lesson in John chapter number 21. Right there at the end of John. So if you find the book of Acts, just come back. That next chapter before that. John chapter number 21. Jesus is resurrected now. He's been appearing to his disciples, showing up in the midst of them. Performing many signs that he's the risen Lord, showing them infallible proofs that he is who he says he is. And now something happens. John chapter number 21, after all these things happen, the disciples are at the sea once again, same place. Now, the Gospel of John calls it the Sea of Tiberias, but really it's the same place, Sea of Galilee or the Lake Gennesaret. Verse number 2, look at this. Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, remember those were Simon's business partners, and two others of his disciples were together. Verse 3, Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. Jesus has been showing up. Jesus has been showing them these proofs. Jesus has been telling them about the kingdom of God. And here they are, and it's kind of like that awkward moment. You know what I mean? Sitting around staring at each other. Waiting. And so Peter's kind of sitting there. And they're by the lake. And Peter finally said what everyone was thinking. I'm going fishing. Now notice what the disciples do right away. Look at this. They said to him, we're going with you also. They went out and immediately got into the boat. Everybody say the boat. Okay. Why is that important? Because it didn't just say a boat. This most likely was Peter's boat. His nets were broke, but apparently somebody there at the lake kept his boat for him. So they got into the boat, right back in. And that night, they caught nothing. Does that sound familiar yet? Verse 4, but when the morning had now come, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Now, if you look how far they were away from shore, you'll find out it's about 100 yards, okay? Talks about that. Verse number 5, then Jesus said to them, children, have you any food? And they answered him, no. Remember, Jesus engages them first on that little shallow level. He's piqued their interest. You got anything, guys? Nah. He's got their attention. And he said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. Now, I don't know about you. I've been fishing. I don't think it really matters that much which side of the boat, right or left, right? Especially when you got a 15-foot long boat. If a fish is over on that side, but I'm casting over here, I understand he's not there in the net. But eventually, if he's swimming that way during the nighttime, I would have caught something. So Jesus isn't necessarily speaking in terms of right and left, but Jesus is speaking once again in terms of obedience. Cast on the right side of the boat. So they cast, and now they were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. In fact, you'll find out later on when they finally drag the net in, the net does not break this time. And there was 153 fish. They counted each and every head. Now, I don't know if they sold all those fish at market and used that money for later on when they went back to Jerusalem. I don't know what they did with that. And yet, it was important that they counted those fish. It was important that they brought them to shore. And when they came to shore, they were met by Jesus with a breakfast for them, fish and loaves. He had fed the multitudes, and now he was feeding his disciples. And it's there on that shore that Jesus once again commissions Peter to shepherd his people. He reinstates him, and he speaks of the future, what's going to happen to Peter and John. Some very significant and important things happen, and he gives them direction for the future. The lesson that we can learn from this section, John chapter 21, lesson number 4 is this. Fish the right way for the right results. Fish the right way for the right results. See, if we're going to do this, if we're going to do anything in life, we've got to do it God's way. You can try and get the right thing the wrong way, but you'll get the wrong results. And God is telling us, I don't want you to do this any other way than my way. Why? Because God's egotistical, because God is, you know, self-absorbed, or he's some maniacal maniac in the heavens, you got to do me. No, because God is right. I heard the story of a man who was put under oath, and he was there, and he's a very humble man. Wouldn't tell you about who he is, but he had several degrees. He was just wise, and they asked him under oath. They said, sir, are you the foremost authority on the subject in the entire land? And he stopped for a second, and he said, yes, I am. There is no one who knows more about this than I do. Later on, one of his fellows came to him, and he asked him, he said, why did you talk about yourself that way? I never hear you tout your own horn. He says, well, I had to. I was under oath. See, he was telling the truth. In the same way, God is right. God is all-knowing. God is all-powerful. And when God gives us direction for life, we need to learn the lesson. Listen, God is not doing this to be mean. God is not doing this to be contrary. God's not trying to make it hard on our lives. God is right. Therefore, when God tells us how to do things, when God says, cast the net on the right side, we need to learn the lesson and do it God's way. When God says, I will make you fishers of men, go preaching everywhere you go. Tell someone about Jesus. We need to start opening our mouths and preach the gospel. It works in every area of your life. When God says, pay taxes, don't cheat on them. When God says, don't cheat on your husband or wife, don't have sex outside of marriage. He's not trying to make life difficult. He's not a killjoy. God is right. And when we cast the net the right way, we'll get the right results. It's not popular, but it's true. And I don't know about you, but guys, I'm just so tired. Stop trying to blow smoke in my face. Stop trying to put the act, I'm tired, tear down the mirrors and the walls. People everywhere are trying to deceive us. I'm so sick of it. Everywhere you turn, there's someone telling you about how much better your life will be if you do it their way. If you use their thing, if you subscribe to this thing, if you get involved on this online or whatever it is, their cause, their thing. I'm so sick of that. Just somebody, would you stand up? And would you just cut the baloney? And would you just tell me like it is? That's why we're here in church. And here at The Rock, we're not going to patty cake with you. We're not trying to get you involved in our thing. I'm trying to get you involved in His thing. Because when you do the right thing, the right way, according to what God says, you will get the right results. Kind of neat, Charles Spurgeon in 1880 on January 1st was asking people to pray for him from his church. I was so impressed with what he wrote. He asked for his congregation to pray for him the upcoming year, and he said, I beg also on my own behalf your prayers that through another year my ministry may be more edifying to the saints, more persuasive with sinners, and more acceptable to the Lord. That should be our prayer each and every day. God, let me just be a blessing to my brothers and sisters in the Lord. God, I pray that you give me the gift of gab when it comes to sinful people. May I be more persuasive. And God, I pray, Lord, that I would be pleasing in your sight each and every day. That's what this is all about. As we learn these lessons from the Master, as we implement them in our lives, not just in witnessing. Yeah, this was a message, yes, primarily about witnessing and telling someone about Jesus. Hopefully you're stirred tonight. Hopefully you walk out of this place tonight and you grab your phone and you start calling everyone you know, texting everyone you know. Hopefully you post it online. Hopefully, it's the gossip at the water cooler at work this week is telling someone about Jesus. Hopefully this stirs you. Hopefully you get radical. Hopefully this congregation starts to change the face of the Inland Empire as well as around the world, because we caught a fire for souls. But also in every area of our life, if we can learn these lessons from the Master, as we implement them in our marriage, in our business, with our parenting, with our friendships and our relationships, in purity, holiness, in our faith, in our trusting God and stepping out, then we will get the right results. When you do it God's way, you're going to get God's results. Can we give the Lord a praise tonight? I want to do this. I want to cast a net right now. I'm going to ask everybody to remain seated. I want everybody to just stay put and listen up, because deep is calling to deep. And already there have been some things that we've discussed tonight that I believe have sounded on the inside of you. Maybe you feel like the psalmist does, that the waves and the breakers have gone over you. You say, what are you talking about? Sometimes when we think about God and when we think about eternity, it can be overwhelming. But I want to just ask you a simple question. Let's start at the ankle, then we'll go to the knee. Eventually, we'll get in waist deep and we'll see how we do, okay? I want to ask you a simple little question. What if tonight was your last night on the earth? Jesus came back, or maybe you died, and that was the end. Where would you go? Would you go to heaven, or would you go to hell? Simple little question, just answer it in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. Now, sometimes people answer that and they say, well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. You know, I think that's a fairy tale made up by parents to scare their children into being good. And, you know, that really is a rude thing to say, that God would be so mean-spirited that he sends people to hell. I don't believe that that's true. And yet, when I look in the Bible, I find that hell's in the Old Testament, in the New Testament. Jesus himself talked about it. It's a very real place. And just by burying your head in the sand and denying its existence doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it, my friends. And God is not mean-spirited, wanting to send people to hell. He's not some, you know, person who delights in our pain. No, God loved us so much that he gave us the opportunity while we're here on the planet to choose where we go. He gave us a free will choice to choose with our lives because he loves us so much. And now tonight, the opportunity is being set before you. Where would you go? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I believe all roads lead to heaven, you know? I think that, you know, you do your thing, I'll do my thing. Churches out there can do whatever they want to do, and we'll all make it to whatever we call heaven somehow, some way, you know? And God's cool with that. As long as we stay true to ourselves, I mean, that's what it's really all about. All roads lead to heaven. Well, you know, if I applied that logic to the earth, you'd think I was crazy. You say, what are you talking about? Well, what if I said this to you? All roads on earth lead to the moon. You'd say, you're crazy. You can drive around the earth as long as you want. You'll never make it. And I would agree with you. So what makes us think that we can do whatever we want to do and all roads will lead to heaven? It doesn't work like that. Can't do your thing or my thing or some well-meaning church committee's thing or stay true to ourselves and that gets us into heaven. Jesus came and he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. What does that mean? That means it's God's heaven. We're going to have to get there God's way. And don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who went to the cross, a beaten, bloody mess, don't you think that after he does all that he would share with us his way? Remember, we talked about the right way. We'll get the right results. And if God wanted us to go to heaven, and he does, don't you think he would share with us the right way to get to heaven? Right here in his word, he does. You guys ready to go to the knees? Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, that's good news because, you know, I know that God lets good people into heaven. And really, I've been a good person. I've seen, you know, that there's injustice in the world. And so I've gotten involved in social justice causes, giving my money to charities, wearing shoes that help people in Africa or drinking water that digs wells overseas. You know, I've been nice to my neighbors. And yeah, I used to be bad, but I cleaned up my act. Now I'm really been good and working on my resume. And I think God sees that and God appreciates that. And therefore, he's going to let me into heaven based on how good I've been. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible, check it out, nowhere does it say how good you have to be in order to get to heaven. In fact, the standard if you want to get to heaven based on your goodness is perfection. No one's perfect. Not one. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We can't be good enough. There's no grading scale, no line that you have to be above in the back of the Bible behind the maps. Be this good and you get to go to heaven. In fact, our goodness, when it's lifted up and compared to God's goodness, is like filthy rags, the Bible says. Not going to make it. Tonight, can I love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth? If that's how you think you're going to get to heaven just by being good, you're not going to make it. Some of you might be thinking, well, Pastor, you don't understand. I was raised in church. Parents told me we were Christians growing up. They hung a cross or a St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child? Went to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. And you're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. We're Christians headed for heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents tell you you're a Christian and raise you in church, that makes you a Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you wear religious jewelry, attend religious classes, or be born in America that you get to go to heaven. I don't see anywhere in the Bible that because you're not some other religion that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven and denying your presence in hell. Come on, let's talk about your eternal life. You say, Pastor, not only when I was a child did I go to church, though. I mean, come on, I'm sitting here in church in front of you right now. And I consider myself to be a Christian. But again, let's apply that logic here on the earth. What if I said, I want to be a Dodger. I just really like the Dodger blue and I want to wear the uniform. So I went down to the sports store, bought myself a Dodger uniform, put it on. Went and got my bat and my ball, drove down to Dodger Stadium in Los Angeles and sat in the dugout, called myself a Dodger, and thought that I was going to get to play in the game. You know what's going to happen. They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. Why? Because I am not a Dodger. In the same way, what makes us think we can just sit in church, call ourselves a Christian, and then abracadabra, alakazam, poof, I'm a Christian? It doesn't work like that. You say, but Pastor, hold on a second. You don't understand. My last church, I got involved. I carried the pastor's Bible. I made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I taught in the Bible class. I even got a membership card to that church that I could show you. Now, well, that's great, and I'm glad you did those things. Could you just show that to me in the Bible? Where you help out, sing in the choir, make decisions. People think of you as a leader. Teaching the Bible classes, you get to go to heaven. It's not there. And I don't see anywhere in the Bible, God is waiting at the gates of heaven looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter. It doesn't work like that. You say, ah, Pastor, okay, I got you on this one. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. You guys ready to go waist deep? It's getting deeper, isn't it? Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. Doesn't that make me a Christian? I know God. I know about Jesus. Celebrate the resurrection at Easter. Sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. And while that's great, I'm glad you can do those things. Just show that to me in the Bible, where you know who God is, where you can celebrate a holiday, where you can quote some scripture that gets you into heaven. That doesn't get you into heaven. How do I know that? Because if you'd read your Bible, you would know that demons know who Jesus is, and that doesn't qualify them for heaven. The devil himself believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't make him a Christian headed for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. Listen, if you're trying to get to God based on your own efforts, your own knowledge, your own strength, how many of you are experiencing this right now? We got waist deep, but there's a river we can't cross. You will not be able to get to God in your own efforts. God had to reach through with his efforts. And Jesus said this. Remember, we're doing this God's way. Jesus said, unless you're born again, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, we hear that term born again and we turn off. We say, ugh, I didn't know this was that kind of church. I didn't know. I've seen that in movies. I've read about it in books and blogs and on the internet and in Hollywood and all that. It's weird. It's not something that I want to be a part of. And yet, are we going to let society, Hollywood, movies, television, books, the internet describe for us what being born again is? No. Let's be wiser than that. Let's find out what the Bible has to say about being born again. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he talking about? Lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, and occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, I'm not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. Now, Jesus said this. Remember, we're doing this God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So tonight, here's your opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hand pop together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 whoa. Wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be embarrassed. Let's get over that tonight. I know the people you came with, you might be thinking, man, they're judging you, they're criticizing you. Might have been invited here tonight for baby dedication or just check out my church and you're embarrassed to raise your hand. But guess what? Can I let you in on a secret? They love you and that's why they brought you here tonight. They want you to do this and they'll be excited for you. They've done it too. We've all done this. Okay, so you're among friends. We're all ex-somethings in this place. All right? Now, will you give God all of your heart? You've got all of your life. Being born again. Headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Probably won't even be embarrassed. But think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one would make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity apart from God? Come on. And yet the devil thinks you're so dumb, he's trying to talk you out of it right now. Listen, he's the dumb one. He's the defeated one. You tell him, go jump in a fiery lake. You're smarter than that. You're going on with God tonight, giving him all of your heart and all of your life. Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure in this place? Come on, tonight is your night. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, giving him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm and you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it? Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, get ready to get your hand up. Come into the church service or telling us you're right afterwards. Online, wherever you're at, come on, God sees you. And as you raise your hand, you're responding to this message right now. And guess what? Right afterwards, you can minimize your video browser and click the blue button that says respond to God. And someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. All together, if you need to do this, on the count of three. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. If that's you, there's one, there's two, there's three. God bless you. Who else tonight? Three wise people already. Four, five, got you over there. Six, seven, eight, got you guys. Right over there. If I've counted you, you guys can put your hands down, okay? I think I got all you guys. Anybody else real quick? There's about eight wise people already. Anybody else? You know you need to give God all of your heart, and you know you need to give God all of your life. Thank you. Nine, 10, got you guys right there. Anybody else real quick? 10 wise people. Anybody else back in the family room that I didn't already see? I'm going to close this up in a moment. Don't miss this opportunity. You've missed enough opportunities in your life. Now is the time. Today is the day of salvation. Come on, we're not assured tomorrow. Listen, just because there's a blood moon doesn't mean Jesus could come back before it. We're not assured tomorrow. Anybody else, you're saying, I know I need to do this. Listen, don't wait a moment longer. If I'm looking your direction, you need to do it. Just lift up your hand. Anybody else real quick? There's 10 wise people already. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 10 wise people. Hallelujah. Now, all 10 of you, or number 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. Hey, it's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. In a moment, we're all going to stand, give a clap and a shout. Elijah's going to lead us in a song. As he sings, that's your cue. Get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Okay, but we can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. No one leaves during this time. And you come. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front right now. Come on down. Come on down.
Thank you, Jesus.
They're coming. Let's give them a hand.
You rescued me.
You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. Hallelujah. Come on, you can come too. You can come too for the families. You can bring your children. They'll remember this. Come on down. They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. Nudge your neighbor. Say, come on, friend. I'll go with you. Let's go. Hallelujah. Hey, you guys. A lot more than 10 up here. Praise God that you guys responded to the call of God. All right, my brother right here, straight out of San Bernardino. I love it, man. That's so cool, you know. But guess what? Now we're coming straight out of hell, and we're headed for heaven. There's a future and a destiny for you guys, all right? Now listen, right over here to my right, see this guy? Waving at you. That's Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. Nothing weird's going on, okay? I want to describe to you what's going to happen. Sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Listen, I'm about as weird as you're getting tonight, okay? With the red socks and everything. He's cool, all right? He's going to do three things. Very simple. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature. Find out what to do next now that you're a Christian, all right? It's easy reading. It's simple. Maybe take about a half hour if you read slow. All right, but it'll just give you some things, what to do next, kind of find your bearings so that you can get going in the things of God. All right, third thing he's going to do, he's going to give you a spiritual personal trainer. You say, what? Okay, we call him an SPT. Basically, it's a friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back to your old ways, that you go on with the ways of God. All right, they'll teach you some more lessons from the Master. Stuff out of the Bible that'll help you to get strong, all right? And it'll be things that will encourage you for the rest of your life. Now listen, let me make a promise to you guys. Give us 1 year of your life here at The Rock, sitting under the teaching consistently here at The Rock Church and World Outreach Center. You can make it Sunday nights, come on, all right? We got Sunday morning church, Wednesday night, got women's Bible studies, young adults ministry going on, all sorts of stuff happening. But consistently for 1 year, if you can come and get under the teaching here, at the end of that year and for the rest of your life, here's the promise. You will look around and say, my goodness, I am just so blessed. It's overwhelming. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right, take their word for it, okay? If you guys make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give them a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to The Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.